मेन एरिया ऑफ इंटरेस्ट आर इंटीग्रेटेड रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी रिसोर्स सिस्टम, डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड जनरेशन, माइक्रोग्रिड एंड इंजीनियरिंग ऑप्टिमाइजेशन. He has published more than 20 papers in reputed national and international conferences and journals. Okay. Now I request A.M. Patel sir to please share the screen and start the presentation.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Jugno. Thanks for introduction. Today I am going to discuss about the assessment of the solar energy resources. The ultimate objective of this session is to make the participant aware about the assessment procedure of the solar energy resources. Because whenever you are going to install any kind of the solar devices, you must know what is the input. So for that, we are commonly knowing that our input is solar and solar energy or the solar radiation gives you. But it is not like that you simply install your system and directly just go and use. You should know whether your input is adequate or not. So for that, the assessment must be done. And for that, you should know the procedure, how it is going to be considered and what values we need to understand and consider for the assessment of solar energy resources. So this will be my presentation outline. I will discuss about why assessment is required. I will something discuss about the sun potential also. Something about the Earth sun revolution. Some interesting topic related to that. And then solar radiation. What are the types? What actually the solar radiation? What are the spectrums of solar radiation? And how it is available to our atmosphere as well as at the Earth's surface. Then some interesting quantities you must know whenever you are assessing the resource of solar energy resources. And finally, then the exercise related to solar resource assessment. So this will be my outline of today's talk. Now the first question is that why we need to assess our resources, right? So this is not just about the assessment of the solar energy resource assessment, not applicable just for the solar energy. It is equally applicable for almost all solar energy. Why? Because solar energy is not a constant. Simple answer, it is not a constant, right? So you cannot say that at this moment, whatever the radiation is available at a particular location, that will remain constant for the next day. It is not like that. It is depends on so many parameters. As I said that it depends on the weather. It also depends on the geographical locations. See here, it is a location specific, region specific, time specific. That means whatever we are right now getting, that will be changes just even after 1 hour, after 2 hours. There is also seasonal variation. So whatever you are receiving at the winter, that will not be continuing in the summer, that will not be continuing the monsoon also. So that is constantly going to change. Local landscape also affect lots on the value of the solar radiation. Then the weather effect, I said also. So these all parameters are changing tremendously the magnitude of solar radiation. So that's why before installing the solar conversion device, whether your device is a solar photovoltaic device or a solar thermal device, you must know what is the solar radiation which is available at a particular location where you are going to develop a solar based system, right? So that's why we need to assess the resources. This is the question, answer for this question, right? So it is an intermittent quantity, and that's why we can say it is not a constant quantity. That's why we need to assess the solar energy resources. Okay, something about the Jugno sir, am I audible clearly?
Okay.
Now something about the solar potential. Now everyone talks about the solar energy is so useful, so it is having so much potential. So we can say citizen or we can say human beings, we must know what the amount of power solar has or what the amount of power we are receiving at the earth's surface from the sun. Everyone knows that it is a big source of energy. It is a mother source of energy. Everything is depending on the solar energy, right? Even life is possible on our planet due to sun. So, but we are not knowing the potential exactly, or we can say as a rough estimate, we should have some idea what the amount of power the sun is releasing. So for that, just interesting figure I would like to share with you, that is, let us see the surface temperature of the sun, that is near about 5500 degree centigrade, that is not so much high, but the core temperature of the sun, that is tremendously high, it is in terms of the millions of degree centigrade, right? But the surface temperature is not high, it is just near about 5 to 6,000 degree centigrade, or just you add something like 273, that will become the Kelvin also. So the power of sun, if you consider, that is near about 384 yotta watt, 10 to the power 24, that is nothing but the yotta watt. So this much amount of power is available from the sun. So what does it mean? If we talk about the 100 watt bulb, then what it is, we can say it is giving a 100 joule per second of energy, right? So sun can also be considered as a big ball of fire. It's a big bulb. It can release this much amount of the power, like 384 10 to the power 24 joule per second. Okay, so this is the power of the sun. Radius of the earth, we are knowing the diameter of the earth, that is near about 12,000 or 600, something like that. So the radius will be 6,371 kilometer. Radius of the sun is 0.7, 10 to the power 6 kilometer. Radius of the orbit, here the orbit means, as we are knowing that the earth is constantly revolving around the sun. So whatever the orbit it follows, that here we are talking about. Okay. So the orbit, that orbit is having a radius of 149 10 to the power 9 meter. Now radius of the earth's orbit, if we take the rough estimate, this radius of the earth's orbit, that is 200 times the radius of the sun. Radius of this orbit, that is 200 times of the radius of this sun. You can see, just simply multiply this into 200, you will get roughly near about this figure. Similarly, the radius of the sun, so 100 times the radius of the earth. So roughly we can say whatever the size of the sun is, that is nearly 100 or 110 times of the earth. So this is just an interesting figure. Everyone must know who is working in the field of solar. Just see the figure. You can see this is the sun. This is a small circle, that is nothing but earth. It is having a radius of 6371 kilometer. The distance between these two, that is the radius of this orbit, 149 10 to the power 9 meter, and the power which is released every second from the sun, that is 384 yotta joule, right? So these are the interesting figure. Now if we want to find out the intensity of the solar radiation, what will be that? So intensity is nothing but the what amount of the power that is available from the sun, considering the per unit area, right? So if you consider the square of the meter square, particularly unit meter square, and what amount of the energy that is coming from the sun and that is available at the each and every surface of the orbit. See, this 384 yotta watt that is coming from the sun, and it is equally distributed in all the direction from the sun, and what amount of that energy, what amount of the joule that is available at this surface of this orbit. So that figure we would like to identify. So that is nothing but the total power from the sun, which is available, 384 yotta watt, divided by the surface area of the orbit, which is nothing but the 4 pi r square. So if you put all this figure here, orbit radius, you have to put 149 10 to the power 9 and square. So simply put pi here, you will find this this figure, 1377 watt per meter square. So this is nothing but the intensity of solar radiation which is available at the surface of the orbit. Okay, at every surface of this orbit, every point. Now Earth is just located at this one of the point of this orbital plane, right? So now we would like to identify what amount of the power the Earth is receiving. Let us see that also. Power received by the Earth, this is what? The intensity available at the orbital surface, 1377 watt per meter square. Now we would like to identify the power received by the Earth. So simply the intensity we identified, this one, watt divided by meter square. So simply multiply it into meter. What is that meter? So it is nothing but the cross sectional area of the Earth. So the power which is available at this point, that is nothing but if you cross this Earth, that area I am talking about. So cross sectional area of the Earth you have to consider and simply multiply it by the intensity of solar radiation which is available at the orbital surfaces. So if you put this area, this pi r square and multiply it with this 1377, you will get this figure, 1.75 10 to the power 17 watt. So what is that? This much amount of energy in terms of the joule is available at every second at the Earth's surface, particularly in the cross-sectional area. Right. Now, let us talk about the energy received. So this is power and now we are talking about the energy. So how much amount of the energy we are receiving from the sun every year? So this much amount of the energy we identified just in the previous slide, that is joule per second, now simply multiplied with the second of the year. So year have a 365 days, 24 hour, 1 hour has 60 minute and 1 hour has 60 minute and 1 minute has 60 seconds. So total of these, that you have to multiply with this figure. So you will find that 5.5 10 to the power 24 joules. Okay. So 5.5 yotta joules you will receive, 10 to the power 24, that is yotta joules. And we can also convert by reducing this quantity 10 to the power 24 in terms of 10 to the power 18. So that 6 degree is reduced and that is nothing but the million. So 5.5 into million, that is nothing but 10 to the power 6 into 10 to 18 joules. So this is just conversion is made just for simplicity or to understand some concept. I am just coming to that. And now this 5.5 million, what is this? 10 to the power 18, that is exajoules. Okay. So like 10 to the power 24, that is yottajoules. 10 to the power 18, that is exajoules. Now, energy which is received by the Earth from the sun every year, see, every year, that is 5.5 million exajoules. Now, if we talk about the consumption of energy for the humankind, whatever the human beings are using every year, that is near about 500 exajoules. This consumption includes every kind of the energy, including the, we can say, conventional energy sources, non-conventional, everything it included, okay. So 500 exajoules we are using every year and we are receiving from the sun 5.5 million exajoules. So this potential can last up to what time? Let us identify that figure also. So the energy used by the humankind every year, that is, it can be received from the sun. So how much time it will take? So energy used by the humanity every year divided by energy received by the Earth from the sun. So simply take the ratio of these two quantity and you will find that 9.1 10 to the power minus 5 years. So within that year, this much amount of the year, we will receive the power from the sun that is equally capable to satisfy the energy demand of the humankind. If we convert it into the days, simply multiply the 365 days per year, year will be cancelled out, it will find figure 0.033. So 0.033, again you convert it in terms of the hour, so you will convert simply day has 24 hours, so multiply it with that and you will get an interesting figure, that is 0.792. So near about 0.8 hour whatever the amount of solar energy you are receiving from the sun, that is capable to satisfy each and every energy demand of the entire planet. So you can imagine what kind of the energy we are receiving from the sun. Even whatever that we just calculated here, if we consider 30% of energy is waste, or we can say we are not receiving by considering the atmospheric attenuation, just like we are assuming that whatever the energy which is coming from the sun, let us say 30% of that is coming back to the sky, then also whatever the figure we are receiving, that is really, really interesting, and that is near about 1.13 hour, and equals to the 1 hour. So within 1 hour, whatever the energy we are receiving from the sun, that is capable, that is equally, we can say it is capable to satisfy all the energy demands of the entire planet, for the whole human being. So this is just the potential of the sun. Now see here, we have total how many hours in a year? 8760. That much hour is available we have in a year, and out of that, within 1 year, we are just 1 year, within just 1 year, whatever the energy that is available, that is sufficient. That is sufficient to satisfy all the needs of human life. Still, we are having so much space, big room space is available for doing so much things, and that is available from this. This is just a solar potential I would like to share with you. Now, the next topic is Earth-Sun revolution. Now, everybody knows Earth is rotating and revolving also. So Earth rotates around its own axis, that is near about 24 hours, and that is the happening of day and night. That's why we are feeling, we are facing the day and night at the different location of the Earth. It revolves around the axis in an orbit surrounding the sun, that is near about 365.25 days. So this additional 0.25 days, that is 1/4 of this day, total day, 1/4 of one day, that is counted and it is adjusted the leap year that we are obtaining every 4 years, which is having a total days equal to 366. Okay. So this is just an interesting concept everybody should know. Now the orbit of the Earth revolving is not a circular, it is a elliptical. Is just like the ellipse, and we are knowing that ellipse have two loci points. So out of that two foci points, at one foci point the sun is located. Okay. Now something about the eccentricity of the distance. As the orbit of the Earth is not a circular, it is elliptical, the distance between the sun and Earth is constantly varying. Constantly means at a large scale, at a very small scale, particularly in a year. And that eccentricity means the variation in the distance between the Earth and Sun, that is near about 1.7%. It is just a very small fraction of the total distance, but it is there. Means the distance is not a constant, it is not revolving throughout the orbital path, and so that at a constant distance. It is not revolving in the orbital path at a constant distance. Now, for that, as the distance is constantly changing, we must know, or we should take a minimum value, a mean value, or the average value of the distance, and that average value is to be taken, and that unit is known as astronomical unit. And the distance, that is 1.49 10 to the power 11, or you can say 149 10 to the power 9. And what will be the variation? It is just like the eccentricity between that, and plus or minus we can say 1.7%. So see this figure. This is sun and this is our Earth. The distance between the center to center, that will be your astronomical unit, and that astronomical unit, this is nothing but the mean distance, which is whatever the distance is on here, that is the mean distance. So this is just the diameter of the sun, diameter of the Earth, and whatever the sun rays which are falling at a particular location of the Earth, it makes a solid angle of 32 degrees. This is also very interesting figure. It is known as a solid angle. Okay, So from the top surface of the sun to the bottom surface of the sun, whatever the rays which are falling at a particular object device, that is a solid. Now let us discuss about the solar radiation. Now solar radiation, it is something about the radiation. So radiation energy. Radiation means the element or the object which is radiating some energy. I must say every object, including the human beings, we are also radiating some energy. Each and every object is radiating some energy. Condition is only that the temperature should be absolute zero, more than absolute zero. Here the absolute zero means Kelvin, 0 degree Kelvin, and it is near about 273.15 or 273.20, like that, minus degree centigrade. Okay. So if any body, any object is under the condition of more than under the condition where the temperature is more than absolute zero, then it is radiating some energy. So this radiation energy is known as electromagnetic radiation. Why it is electromagnetic radiation? Because it, that rays, that waves, that energy is affected by the electric field as well as magnetic field also. That's why it is known as electromagnetic radiation also. The characteristics of this radiation is such that it does not require any kind of the medium to travel. Like, see, the sun is coming, sun is radiating energy. That radiation is directly comes to the atmosphere of the earth and then comes to the earth surface, and beyond the atmosphere there is a vacuum, there is a space, so that is also passing through the space, that atmosphere, and finally reaching to the earth surface. That means it does not need any medium to travel. Okay, it can travel anywhere. It can be also considered as a particle. That particle is also known as photon. As per the particle wave duality theory, that is nothing but the concept of the quantum mechanics. So as per that concept, you can assume, you can consider that wave as a particle, and that particle is nothing but the photon. This photon is a packet of energy. It is having a certain energy. It is radiating. So, okay, that is coming from the sun. Now this radiation energy, as in the earlier figure also I said, it is radiating in all the direction, not towards just the earth. The sun is radiating the solar radiation in all the direction, equally distributed it is. It is not just like a bias that this planet is having a higher solar radiation, some another planet is having a lower solar radiation. That is not like that. Sun is radiating energy in all direction and it is equally distributed. So the characteristics of this, only the condition is that it is uniformly distributed, of course, but the wavelength, which is nothing but the characteristics of the electromagnetic wave, is different. Each and every photon, or we can say each and every segment of the spectrum, it is having a different frequency, different wavelength. So that is the characteristics of solar radiation. And if we talk about the characteristics, see here, different wavelengths of the different radiations are given here. That is commonly known as the spectrum electromagnetic distribution, spectral distribution of the solar radiation also you can say. So 10 to the power minus 6, if the wavelength is less than 10 to the power minus 6, that rays are known as cosmic rays. So cosmic rays having the wavelength less than 10 to the power minus 6, then from 10 to the power minus 6 to 10 to the power minus 3, that belongs to X-rays and gamma rays. Then from the next range is for the far ultraviolet, then middle ultraviolet, near ultraviolet, then the visible range. So a human eye can see this range only. That's why it is known as visible range, 0.38 to 0.72 micrometer. So all those radiation which are falling in this range, that only is a visible range for the human eye. Then the next, on the higher side, it belongs to the category of infrared. Just like the previous, if it is lower then it is a ultraviolet, then it is a higher than it is known as an infrared. So infrared IR, it is again near, middle and far. then microwaves, radio frequency is having a higher frequency and lower wavelength, like this. So the topic, important thing is that the human eyes can see only this thing. It cannot see these ultraviolet as well as it cannot see the infrared waves. But the solar radiation is consisting this UV portion also as well as IR portion also. Of course, the cosmic portions are not available in the solar radiation. See, the range is like 0.15 to 3. 0.15 is something falls between these two. Far here, far UV, and 0.3, that is something over here, middle IR. So solar radiation at the Earth's surface, see here, not at the space, at the Earth's surface, whatever is available, that is. Am I audible clearly?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So that falls between this range. Now, how to understand the spectral distribution? Spectral distribution. To understand the concept of spectral distribution of the solar radiation, we are considering the sun as a black body. Okay, so that black body is maintained at this much exactly amount of the surface temperature of the sun. So what is exactly black body is, it is a just idealistic assumption. Okay, it is an idealistic assumption. That means a black body can absorb everything and it can emit everything. So it is having the absorptivity and the emissivity is equal to 1, and at the same time reflectivity and transmittivity is 0. Okay, so this is just an assumption to understand what the solar radiation is available at the Earth's surface, just by taking an idealistic assumption that the sun is a black body and it is maintained at a temperature of this much amount of degree Kelvin or centigrade also you can consider, just by taking some value difference. The radiation spectrum that we receive on the Earth's surface, of course, it is not exactly matched with the what we can say black body radiation, but it is good, because whatever the radiation we are receiving, considering the assumption of black body, that is exactly not matching, but it is good for starting to understand the concept of the sun radiation. See this figure. So, see, the yellow portion indicates the radiation which is available at the top of the atmosphere, and the black curve, this dark line curve, that indicates the black body spectrum. Both are nearly what we can say comparable. See here the top value, starting values, some difference is there of course, but we can consider this black body assumption for understanding the radiation available at the atmosphere. So you should know that the radiation at the top atmosphere, this is not the radiation which is available at the Earth's surface till now. We are talking about the radiation which is available beyond the atmosphere. Okay, so that radiation which is available beyond the atmosphere, that is exactly matches with the spectrum of the black body. Now, something about the radiation types. So, there are three kind of the radiations: diffuse, direct, and the reflective. So, first one is the diffuse radiation. When the sun rays passes through the Earth's atmosphere, some portion of it is getting absorbed and reflected also by so many particles which are available in the atmosphere, and due to that the intensity of the solar radiation is getting reduced. So this finally, those radiation which are reaching to the Earth's surface after subjecting to the scattering, to the absorption, to the reflection, that is known as diffuse solar radiation. It is also known as diffuse horizontal irradiance, DHI. You will find this abbreviation DHI in many books. Now the direct solar radiation. The sun's radiation which is available at the Earth's surface without being diffused. Means it is not subjected to any absorption, it is not subjected to any scattering as well as reflection. It is directly coming from the sun and reaches to the Earth's surface. So this is known as direct solar radiation. It is also known as a beam solar radiation. So it is equal to the extraterrestrial solar radiation minus the atmospheric losses. What is extraterrestrial solar radiation? That I am just coming to after few slides when we discuss about the important quantities. Right now assume it is some figure. After that, that means it is whatever available at the beyond the atmosphere and minus the atmospheric loss and directly reaching to the Earth's surface. That is a direct or the beam solar radiation, and you will find this figure abbreviation DNI in many books also related to this direct solar radiation. It is direct normal radiance. Now the reflected, so any solar radiation which is coming to the Earth's surface or any other surface and directly falling onto the application. Suppose we are going to install one solar conversion device at a particular location, and we are receiving some solar radiation which is reflecting from the some nearby object like the mirror, like stone, even from the ground also. So that is known as a reflected solar radiation. So these are the three basic kind of the solar radiations that we need to consider whenever we are using a particular application based on the solar system. So this is just a indication through a figure. See here, the sun is radiating the energy. Some energy is directly coming to our device. See, this is known as a direct solar radiation. It is also known as beam solar radiation. Some solar radiation is obstructed by the object like the clouds, and it is reflected back into the space. Sometimes it may happen that it is obstructed by the cloud and it may reflect to the ground surface also. Again, it is reflected back and come to the our object. So that is also possible. See here, one solar rays comes to the ground and it is reflected back to the surface of the object. Some solar radiation are getting absorbed also due to the suspended particle of the atmosphere like the water vapor, aqueous, ozone. These all three gases are also responsible for absorbing the solar radiation. After that, the solar radiation may get scattered from that. That means the direction may change. So this is the atmospheric scattering. Due to a particle which are available in the atmosphere, the rays are getting scattered. So, and then suppose it comes to the surface of the Earth, then it is known as diffuse solar radiation. So those solar radiation which are subjected to the we can say absorption as well as scattering, those are known as diffuse solar radiation. And those solar radiation which are coming directly to our object or the area of interest where we are going to install our device, that is known as direct solar radiation. Now the question may come, how to identify these quantities? So there are certain devices available which are equally capable to measure this all kind of the radiation. So there are two basic devices used for measurement of the solar radiation. The pyranometer, which measures the global or total irradiance on a plane. So global means what? So global, this term is very common. You will find that in every book also, in research publications also, in literatures. Global means total. It is a combination of beam as well as we can say diffuse solar radiation, right? So this pyranometer is measures the global solar radiation, which is nothing but the summation of the beam as well as diffuse solar radiation. Then the next meter, which is a pyrheliometer. Pyrheliometer measures only just the beam solar radiation. So its design is such that it can measure only a direct or the beam solar radiation. So these are the two devices widely used for measurement of the solar radiation. About the atmospheric attenuation. Atmospheric attenuation means reduction in the value. How the quantity is getting attenuated. Here we are talking about the solar radiation. So how the solar radiation is getting reduced, or we can say attenuated through atmosphere, right? So what is atmosphere? Atmosphere is nothing but the concentric circle which is exactly available on the top of the earth, top of our planet. It is having a length of 10 kilometer, roughly 10 to 12 kilometer, right? So this atmosphere is having a different particles which is available in it. So many particles are there, and that attenuates the intensity of the solar radiation. It reduces the intensity. And what it consists? It consists mainly the different gases. Mostly we are knowing that the nitrogen and oxygen is available in the Earth's atmosphere. Some suspended particles are there, some minute solid and the liquid particles are also there. That is nothing but the vehicle exhaust and the industry exhaust also. Some moisture particles and other suspended water particles are also there. These all particles, what they are doing? They are doing, they are reducing the intensity of solar radiation. By how? They are reducing it by atmospheric absorption, atmospheric scattering. So these are the two main things, scattering and absorption, through the radiation intensity is going to be reduced. So these two major things have happened in the atmosphere of the Earth. Whenever the solar radiation or the sun rays passes through the atmosphere, the first thing that is absorption. Okay, and this absorption is mainly due to the dust particle, gas particle and moisture particle. Okay, so the sun rays which are absorbed by these atmospheric particles, and that's why we can say it is reducing the intensity of the solar radiation. Now interesting thing is that it is spectrally selective. Spectrally selective means, as we just discussed before few slides, a spectrum of the solar radiation, like the ultraviolet rays, UV rays, then visible rays, okay. So out of that spectrum, only a few portion is absorbed by the atmosphere, not all part, not the visible light, not even the IR light also. So mostly the UV part is absorbed by the atmosphere, and mostly that happens in the ozone layer. And the primary gas which are responsible for the atmospheric absorption, that is ozone, O3 and the CO2 also. Water vapor is also there. These are the major absorbers. And we should thank to these gases also, because they are reducing, they are almost, we can say, suppress the UV rays. That's why UV rays are not coming to the Earth's surface, and that's why it is safe for the human beings. If it is coming to the Earth's surface, what may happen? We are knowing everything, what are the consequences of the ultraviolet rays also. It causes many skin cancers also. So we should thank to these gases. Now the second important thing is a scatter. Scattering means just changing the direction. Scatter, right? So it's changed the incoming solar radiation direction. Again, it is also spectrally selective, and basically there are two scattering that occurs into the Earth's atmosphere, that is Rayleigh scattering and then Mie scattering. And due to this small molecules which are available into the atmosphere, which are basically a gas molecules, due to that the scattering is happening. And we cannot predict that in which direction the sun rays may go. That is totally unpredictable. So atmosphere plays a significant role in the solar radiation that we determine at the Earth's surface. Whatever we are receiving on the Earth's surface, it is having a certain advantages also, it is having certain drawbacks also. Means we are not getting a UV light, a UV rays, that is advantage. We are getting reduced intensity solar radiation at the Earth's surface, that is a drawback. So a very common thing is that if the length of the atmosphere is high, the atmospheric attenuation is high. It has to, sun rays has to pass across the more length of the atmosphere. That means it will reduce the intensity of the solar radiation also. Now, height that we are knowing, 10 to 12 kilometer. Now, so this is the solar spectrum which we are getting at the Earth's surface. Now, see, previously we discussed about this curve, this one. This whatever the sun rays available, or we can say solar radiation that is available, yellow I am talking about, the first one, radiation at the atmosphere, top of the atmosphere. Here, this radiation are not subjected to the atmospheric attenuation because it is top of the atmosphere, right? The black body radiation, black line. Now, in this figure C, The dark line curve is a black body radiation. The yellow line is beyond the atmosphere, yellow. And at the Earth's surface, whatever the radiation we are getting, that is subjected to the atmospheric attenuation, and that's why you can clearly observe the intensity at the peak point. See, at the peak, the value is drastically reduced. Similarly, at the different stages, here also, and these are nothing but the atmospheric attenuation, that is absorption. And that absorption is majorly done by this absorbent like the H2O, CO2, ozone, O3, here also you can see. So these all gases are playing a significant role and play role as an absorbent and reduce the intensity of the solar radiation. Now air mass. Air mass is also very interesting quantity because it gives the information like whatever the length the sun rays has to cross the atmosphere and reaching to a particular object, that is not much. Why? Because the sun is sun is not moving, we are moving around the sun, our planet is moving. So apparent motion between the sun and earth, the distance of the sun rays starting from the morning to evening, that is not constant. So at a particular location, if we talk about your position, wherever you are sitting, wherever you are living, residing, at that location, the length of atmosphere that the solar radiation has to cross to reach that location is not constant, because the sun position is constantly changing, starting from the sun rises and at 7 p.m., 8 p.m., at every different location, at a particular location with respect to time, the position of the sun is constantly changing. Okay, so the air mass is indicating that quantity. How? See, it is the actual length, it is the ratio of the actual length of atmosphere, the solar radiation covering, actual length, divided by the minimum length of the atmosphere that the sun rays has to cover. And if it is same, then AM will be 1, and that is nothing but the noon. At the noon, what will happen? The actual length, the atmosphere, length of the atmosphere that the sun rays has to cover, that is the same as the minimum length, because the minimum length will be at the noon. At whatever location you are residing, just see at the top, at the zenith position, means at the exactly top position, the distance of the sun rays that has to travel to reach your location, that is minimum. And that will be the actual. That's why AM will be 1 at the noon. And it will be high for the other time. Other time means during the morning, during the evening also. Right? So, as the AM increases, the solar radiation intensity decreases. And so, that's why we are facing less intensity in the morning and in the evening. Whenever the sun rises and sun sets, the intensity of the sun, or we can say intensity of the solar radiation which we are feeling at our location, that is reduced, and during that moment the AM is high. So why we consider these all things? Because if we want to develop any solar project, we must consider the reference value, and for that the reference value consider is AM 1.5. So all the solar devices, like the any solar photovoltaic module, that is also having a certain efficiency, fine. So that efficiency is identified considering this AM value, that is 1.5, right. So air mass is equal to 1.5. Again, there are certain other condition also, by like the temperature of the cell 25 degrees centigrade and the radiation intensity, that is 1000 watt per meter square. So these are the standard testing condition, and under that testing condition or the standard condition, the specification of the solar photovoltaic module or any conversion device is identified, or it is given, designed. So that's why this is reference frame is designed. So you can see the concept again through this figure. See here the sun, and here the observer location. So distance that the sun ray has to cross the atmosphere from this to this, and the minimum distance again, so that is also this to this. So at this particular location, the AM will be 1. Okay, both top and numerator and denominator will be one length as well as minimum length. Now, as the sun is moving either in this direction or in this direction, so any one direction is the east, another direction is the west. So sun rises in east and sets in the west. So during this different position, what will happen? This angle is goes increasing, and also simultaneously the AM value is also going to be increases. And with that also, the intensity of solar radiation is going to reduce. Again, see the solar radiation spectrum again in terms of the, in context with the AM value. So AM zero, atmospheric attenuation is not there, air mass is zero, that means what? It is beyond the atmosphere. So whatever the blue line is given, that is beyond the atmosphere. Whatever the solar radiation intensity available above the atmosphere, that is AM zero. AM 1.5, that is this one, black line. And the red line indicates again the black body. Of course, some difference is given in terms of the temperature. Some book, some authors suggest 5,500. Some authors suggest 5,762. Some authors suggest between any two values between 5,000 to 6,000. You can consider it. Okay. So this is just a solar spectrum of the in context with the AM. Now, wherever we are going for resource assessment, some quantities you should know. So that quantities we are going to discuss here right now. So quantities to know before the assessment. Assessment means the resource assessment I'm talking about. So the first important thing is latitude. So what the latitude, everybody knows, we already studied in our schooling time also. But once again, I would like to give us some flavor about that. So see, it is the angle between the lines joining the Earth center to the location with its projection. Now see, let me discussion with the figure. So let us say, for example, you are locating, you are residing here at this location. Okay, so this is your location at this position, and this is Earth's surface. It is having a curvature. Now, if we join this position with respect with the center of the Earth, and if it is getting projected onto the equatorial plane, so this is equatorial plane, equator we can say. So equator is bisecting the Earth in exactly two parts. First part is towards the northern hemisphere. On the lower side, it is towards the southern hemisphere. So what angle we are talking about, that is latitude, and latitude is nothing but the angle between the this point, means the observer location joining to the center of the Earth. So this line and observer location is getting projected onto the equatorial plane. So this angle. So this will be the latitude, right? And what will be the value of this latitude? So this latitude is zero here at the equator. Latitude is zero. And as soon as you are going towards the pole, northern hemisphere, the latitude angle is going to increase. Here it is 30. Then again 60 or somewhere here, yes, here, and then it is 90 at the exactly the North Pole. So North Pole is latitude is 90 degree north. Now same thing on the negative side, or we can say towards the south. So again there is a latitude of minus 30, minus 60, minus 90 exactly at the southern pole. So this is the latitude. So its values varies between minus 90 to plus 90, and the plus value is considered towards the northern hemisphere, and minus value is considered towards the southern hemisphere. Now the declination angle. This is a very, very interesting and very important angle. So what is that? It is defined as the angle between the lines joining the center of the Earth to the center of the Sun. So Earth center and the sun center, these two lines, okay, with what? With its projection on the equatorial plane. Here equatorial plane is considered as a reference frame. So whatever the angle we are considering, that is in context with the equatorial plane. So what exactly it is? It is the line joining between the center of the Earth and center of the sun, and the same line is getting projected onto the equatorial plane. So between that two line, whatever the angle is created, that is a declination angle. So this declination angle is indicated by delta. Mostly in all the books you will find this, it is indicated by the delta. So the variation in delta is due to the inclination of Earth's polar. We will see come to this point also. Earth's polar axis and its revolution around the sun. Why it is getting varied? So it is getting varied due to this Earth's polar axis. It is having a certain angle and of course the revolution around the sun. And this is the equation which we are using for identifying the magnitude of the declination angle. So it depends on one quantity. See here, everything is a constant, 23, 4, 5, 3, 6, 0, 3, 6, 5, 2, 8, 4, everything is constant instead of this n. So what is n? N is nothing but the number of days in a year. So for example, the 1st January, if we talk about the 1st January, so 1st January is the first day. If it is 5th January, then n is equal to 5. If it is 31st January, then it is 31st. If it is 5 February, then 31st plus 5. You have to successively add the figures, right? So for 31st January, it is 31st, but for 1st February, it is not 1st, but it is 36th. For 2nd February, it is 37th. For 3rd Feb, it is 38, like that. So let me explain through this figure. This is very good figure for understanding this concept. Now see here, the sun is located at the center of this one of the foci of this elliptical orbit. Now there are four different positions of the Earth is considered here. The first one, second, third and fourth. Of course the dimension is not appropriate in this figure because the sun size is shown lower compared to the Earth. Actually it is reverse. So we are not considering that, just ignore it. So these four positions, the first position, let us talk about the June 21. So in this position, the summer is there. Summer in where? Summer in the northern hemisphere. And why it is so? See, actually it is not like that. The figure is indicated by this arrow, see here. So in this position, actually the Earth position is like that, like this. So this Earth will be over here and you can see clearly the polar axis of the Earth is slightly inclined. It is not exactly vertical. Okay. So it is inclined. So just assume that this figure is over here. So what will happen? You have to connect the sun rays, or we can say center of the sun, to the center of the Earth. That is the exact definition. See here. That is the angle between the line joining the center of the Earth and the center of the sun. Fine. So center of the sun, you have to join it over here, center of the Earth. See here. So that's why it creates an angle of this delta. Right. So that is the declination angle. And at what location this sun is striking onto the Earth at this particular position? It is exactly striking onto the Tropic of Cancer. Kirkwood, which we are normally indicating the name of that Tropic of Cancer, that is, and it is having a latitude of 23.45, and that's why the declination angle at this position is a 23.45, right? And the interesting thing is that here the day length is highest. In year, the day length at this particular location, the highest day length the human being will face, particularly in context with the northern hemisphere. So the summer will be in the northern hemisphere, at the same time the winter will be in the southern hemisphere. Okay. Now if again this Earth is revolves and comes to this position, what will happen? At this position the sun center is directly comes in the contact with the equator. That means it is directly striking to the center of the Earth through the equator, and that's why the declination angle at this position is zero. And the same position also created at this position number 4 at the March 20, here September 20, some authors suggest 21, some authors suggest 20. So this figure, this 21, 22, 20 and 21, these figures normally lies in the range of 20, 21 and 22. But mostly the accepted value is 21. Okay. We are knowing that the longest day on the Earth is 21st in context with the northern hemisphere. So at these two positions, this vertical and this one, it is known as the equinoxes. it is known as equinoxes. And at the equinoxes, the declination angle is zero. The equinoxes declination angle is zero. Again, it moves and comes to this position. So exactly happens here, the reverse of this position, and here the Earth's surface in contact with the northern hemisphere, it feels the winter. Okay, so that's the winter here, in particularly in contact with the northern hemisphere. So at what location the sun rays are striking? See here, this figure. So sun rays are striking at this point, and this point of interaction, that is nothing but the Tropic of Capricorn, which is Tropic of Capricorn, and it is having a latitude of, because it is located towards the south, it is having a latitude of -23.45 degrees, and that's why the declination angle at this position is -23.45. It is having the longest night in we can see a surface at this particular location in contact with the northern hemisphere. And for this equinox position, the day length will be exactly same. At both the equinoxes, the day length will be same. So these are the some facts I would like to share with you. Everyone should know what is the importance of this declination angle. As in the figure, in the equation, you might have observed, it depends only on the N. So N means number of the day in a particular year. So at a one particular day, the N value will be different. At second day, 2nd January, delta will be different. Third day, it is different. Like that, up to 365, it is different. All the values will be different, right? And here, it is also mentioned that the variation is due to this polar axis and the revolution. So assume this position, it is inclined towards the sun at this position, that's why it is feeling summer over here. It is again moving. It is, see here in this figure, the polar axis is slightly inclined, it is not just a vertical. It is this end, north south pole is a inclined axis, not a vertical axis, and that's why. And due to the revolution, Earth is itself is revolving around the sun as well as on its own axis. Within on axis also, Earth is getting rotating, and that rotation occurs in 24 hours. So that's why, due to this rotation, at every moment, what we are, the sun rays which are facing directly to the center of the Earth, that is getting changed. That's why the declination. So as a rough estimate, the average value you can see through this curve, -23.45, starting from that value, it varies like this throughout the year. So at June, you will find the summer solstice, maximum day length. Here the winter solstice, that is the maximum night length, and these are the equinoxes. Equinoxes means where the seasons are going to change, like the spring and the autumn. Okay, so these are the equinoxes. Where no declination angle, that means no variation in the length of the day and night. Day and night length are exactly equal. Now our angle is nothing but it is indicating the time of the day with respect to sun position, and Earth is rotating. We are knowing that 360 degrees, so in a 24 hour, Earth is rotating 360 degrees. So in a one particular hour, it is rotating through 15 degrees. Okay, it is measured with respect to solar noon. Solar noon means exactly at the zenith position. With respect to that, we are measuring the hour angle. It is positive for the towards the east. Means towards the east means we can say a sun rises, where the sun is rises and reaches to the noon. That position, that time, that angle is considered as a positive. And towards the west, or we can say towards the when in the direction when the sun is sets, that direction is considered as negative, and variation is from +80 to -180. Solar constant, so it is the value of the solar radiation, or we can say intensity of the solar radiation, not the value, intensity means per unit area in a particular quantity of the solar radiation available in a per unit area. Right. So that intensity of solar radiation outside the atmosphere of the Earth, that is the solar constant. and that we see earlier also 1377 during the solar potential in the first slide, first two three slides. Okay, so that value here again I am highlighting, it is known as a solar constant. It is fixed, right? Of course, the measurement techniques are different, or so many other authors also suggested different techniques, and the values they suggested is also different. And you will find in different books this variation in terms of the 1322 to 1395, and mostly acceptable value is 1367 or 1377. That is mostly used in research works. So, through a figure again you can understand this concept of the solar constant. Like this, sun rays are directly coming to the surface of the earth. So this is the atmosphere, see, this is earth and this is the atmosphere. So beyond the atmosphere, whatever the solar radiation available at this surface per unit area, that is your solar constant. Now, extraterrestrial solar radiation, we discussed earlier also, and I promised that I will understand it, I will give an understanding about that in a later stage. So, it is meaning the solar radiation which is available outside the atmosphere. Outside the atmosphere, here the condition is that it comes in a normal direction. Okay. So, whatever the solar radiation which is available at the edge of the atmosphere and comes normal to this surface, or the normal to the plane which is located over here, and that is known as extraterrestrial solar radiation. It can be calculated using this formula, ISC. ISC is nothing but the solar constant, which is 1377. You can consider for calculation purpose 1367 also acceptable value, and just put the n value here. So n again, it is the number of the days throughout the year it is going to change, but you have to consider the successive value, starting from 1st January to 31st December. So this is the variation throughout the year, January, February, March, up to all the month, the variation of the extraterrestrial solar radiation which is available. And if we take the average value of these all, then you will find this constant line. This constant line is nothing but the solar constant. Okay, average of all this extraterrestrial solar radiation, that is, we can say solar constant. Now the most important part we are reaching finally, that is resource assessment. Why we need to assess the resource that we discuss? Because we want to install a solar conversion devices at a area of interest or at a location of interest. At a different location it might be for everyone. So before designing that, before selecting that, we must estimate what kind of the solar radiation is available at that particular point. So to estimate that or to predict that, we have to do certain exercise, and we need a historical data. This is very important. We should have a historical data. Okay. So without which we cannot predict, like in any kind of the prediction, weather prediction also, they are using the historical data. What is, and they are identifying, they are determining the relation factor, or the, we can say, fitting parameters, and using different techniques you can fit that value and identify the what will be the future value. Okay, so the thing is that you need to rely upon the historical data. Larger the database, accurate the database, the better will be the prediction result. If you have a large database, you can understand variety of the relation through different techniques. If it is having the accurate values also, then also the result of the estimation will be good. And mostly in terms of the solar radiation, the linear regression model, or the linear model, we can say linear model most widely used, it is acceptable worldwide. And the equation for that is, you can see H bar divided by HC bar is equal to A prime plus B prime in a bracket S A bar divided by SP bar. Here the fitting parameters are the A prime and B prime. Okay, that is coming from the historical data. It is of course a location specific, or we can say region specific. Whatever the data available to you for that particular location, object location, from that you have to identify the fitting parameters A and B. Okay. Now, what is edge? Here, every quantity is having a h bar. Before that, you understand what is edge. Simple edge. That is just a daily global solar radiation. And important thing is that it is on the horizontal surface. Okay, daily global solar radiation on the horizontal surface. Now, what is h bar? H bar is a monthly average value of that particular daily average, daily global solar radiation. So whatever the H is there, the average, if you talk about the January month, then it is having a 31 values for a daily global solar radiation. And if you take the average of that, that will be the monthly average value of that particular month, January, we can say, for example. So that will be indicated here H bar by H bar. HC bar is nothing but the clear sky assumption. It is the same one. H bar is monthly average data, and this HC is a monthly average data under the clear sky assumption. Means clear sky means we are assuming that the value which is available, solar radiation value which is available, is under the clear sky. Means there is no cloud, no aerosols are there. Aerosol means dust particles, suspended particles, both ozone, CO2, and other pollutants also, these gases are absent. So that we are assuming. SA bar, that is monthly average of duration of actual sunshine. So at an area of interest, at an object location, what actually this sunshine over is available, that we need to identify. Okay. Then SP bar, that is monthly average duration of possible sunshine over. So possible means, what is possible sunshine over at a particular location based on certain data statistics that we need to identify. So these two quantities are related to the sunshine over, means how much time the sun is available. That simple thing. Simple thing that they are indicating is actually how much time the sun is available and what possible time for that the sun is available. Right. So on the right hand side and left hand side of this equation, just an earlier equation, and left hand side both, the term in the denominator are from the historical data. So this is a historical data. This is also possible historical data, because based on, suppose you are having a 30 year data, 30 year of the solar radiation data, based on that you can identify what will be the possible sunshine over during the past few years. Sorry, that is possible. The quantities given in the numerator, both on the right hand side and left hand side, need to estimate for our particular location. So at a particular location, in a different geographic location, if you want to install a thermal device or the solar photovoltaic device, you have to identify the numerator on both the sides, means a global value of the solar radiation on the horizontal as well as the actual sunshine hour which is available at that particular location. Okay. So, based on the available data, you can fit the data and you can identify the relation. Now, we talked about the clear sky assumption, that is quite dubious, it is unpredictable, or we can say it is quite difficult also. We cannot assume such things because of aerosols and the other dust and the suspended particles which are always possible in the atmosphere. And that's why that assumption is quite wrong. So instead of that, what we can do, we can consider the extraterrestrial solar radiation, which is a constant always. It is a robust benchmark. It is not going to change. Why? Because the extraterrestrial solar radiation, it is the radiation which is available beyond the atmosphere. So no atmospheric attenuation is considering any role in reducing the intensity of solar radiation. That's why instead of the clear sky assumption in the denominator on the left hand side, what we are using? We are using H naught bar. Okay. So that is nothing but the solar extraterrestrial solar radiation. And again, it is a bar value, that means monthly average extraterrestrial solar radiation. Right. Monthly average bar chai, it is having a bar, that means it is indicating a monthly average value of the solar radiation, extraterrestrial solar radiation. Okay. Now, for a horizontal plane, at a terrestrial region, what we need to do, whatever the IO and there, we have to multiply it with a certain angle, right? So just assume that you are yourself residing at a particular location. You are assuming that you are at an object location where you are going to develop your conversion, you are going to install your conversion device. So just look at the sun and think that with respect to horizontal plane, what the angle you are creating. So that is theta h, right? So that is the angle of incidence which makes with the horizontal plane, right? So that simply you have to multiply with the ION, which is nothing but the normal intensity of the solar radiation on the atmosphere, okay? Beyond the atmosphere, extraterrestrial region. So from that we will get this value, and here the theta h, it can be obtained through this figure, this equation. See, this all equation I am showing here, that is an empirical equation. It is obtained through so many experiments, and that is already available in the literature. So many variants are also there in the days, but it is important thing is that it is empirical equations. We are not going to derive it here, we are just using it, okay? So I am just giving that we have to use this equation for identifying the inclination angle. Now see here again why inclination angle is important. It is depending on to the L, which we all discussed, this latitude, declination angle, hour angle, okay? So this incident angle is depending on to the location, it depends on to the sun position, okay, throughout the year, delta means throughout the year, and sun position in a particular day. So that is omega, right? So these all quantities, L, delta and omega, we already discussed in the important quantity part. So that's why just by using these all quantity, you can simply find out the theta h, okay? So ION, what is ION? Again, we already discussed ION earlier here. ISC, solar constant, which is nothing but 1377 into this quantity. So you, in a particular day, let us say 31st March, so N is equal to 31st March, at that time, what will be the ION? You have to identify that. And after identifying that, you simply put here at 31st March, latitude is fixed. Declination angle, again you have to identify at 31st mark, declination angle will be different, and this omega also you have to identify. So simply by putting these all values, you can identify the IOH. Now the daily energy which we are receiving on the horizontal surface, that is what? It is constantly changing, starting from the sun rises to sunset, okay? So now the hour angle comes into the picture. So minus omega s to plus omega s, that means from the starting from the sun rises to sunset, whatever the amount of energy which we are receiving, it is nothing but the integration of this energy which we are getting at a horizontal surface. And if we are integrating that, what we got? We'll get this h naught. That is nothing but daily extraterrestrial solar radiation. It is a daily value, extraterrestrial value, and solar radiation, okay? So at zero. So omega s, again, this is empirical equation. It depends on to the latitude as well as the declination angle. For example, for a particular location at 6 a.m. solar time, what will be the hour angle? So just take a difference of that, 12 minus 6, and just multiply it with the 15, that will be your hour angle for that particular moment. So at 6 a.m. you will find 15 degree into 6. That will be your hour angle. Why 15 degree? Just to convert it into the degree. And because in each hour, the earth is rotating through 15 degree. That's why 15 is coming here. Now the next value, next point, next task is we have identified this at zero. Now we need to identify the monthly average. That is H naught bar. So again, to identify the monthly average value, there are certain methods, two methods basically. So in the first method, what we are doing to find the value of each day in a month, find the value for this H0 for each day. Means suppose if we talk about the January month, we have to identify this H0 for all the 31st day. Okay, then sum it up and take the average. That is the simplest one. Okay. And another method is to identify the average day. Identify the average day and identify the solar radiation, extraterrestrial solar radiation of that day, and indicate it as a monthly average value. So define the average day. So that average day of that particular month, that is also known as a Julian day, that is already fixed throughout the globe. After the so many experiments, these days have been fixed for the January 17, February 16. And similarly, you can see here the N value is also going to be successively increased. 17 plus 16, 47, 47 plus 16, 40, 75 plus 15, like that. So just you have, sorry, not like that. This plus February 16, so this plus 16 and successively you add. Means March 16, that means 31st January plus 28 February plus 16 March, that will be your 75. Similarly, 15 March, so 31st January, 28 February plus 31st March plus 15 April, so that will be 105. So like that you have to identify N values and the Julian day, that means you need to calculate the monthly average daily solar radiation at this particular day, and that is exactly equivalent to the average value of the daily extraterrestrial solar radiation which is available. Now the next task will be on the right hand side denominator SP bar. So possible sunshine hour, what is that? So the equation for that is 2 omega S divided by 15 by 2, because we want to cover the full length of the day starting from rising to sunset. So that's why 2 into omega S divided by 15. So again you can put here cos omega S is equal to cos inverse of minus 10 L and delta, which we discussed. Okay, so in this way you can calculate the SP magnitude. Now we want to identify the monthly average value. Again you can follow the same value, same method, just by the previous method, this method 1 and method 2. Whatever the average value, whatever the magnitude of the average monthly extraterrestrial solar radiation we got, using the same methodology we can also identify the SP, possible sunshine hour. Okay. So this is our first task we completed. Now, whatever the daily, monthly average daily global solar radiation is available, out of that how much is diffuse and how much is beam, that also we need to know. Because our sum conversion devices works on the total global solar radiation, sum conversion devices only works on the beam or the direct radiation like the concentrator. So we need to separate it out. So once the total solar radiation is predicted, we have to identify, separate out the beam and diffuse. So for that, beam fraction is defined HT by H, which is actually a function of KT. KT is nothing but the clearness index. Again, what is KT? It is indicating the how much sunshine hour is available. So you can see H divided by H naught. So H is a daily global solar radiation divided by daily extraterrestrial solar radiation. So that is H, and HT by H is a function of this KT. And for the Indian climate, this equation is used 1.411 minus 1.696 KT bar. Here KT bar, that means it is a monthly average value. For all the month, it is a monthly average value. Okay. So now once we have the HT diffuse fraction, simply just subtract it from the 1. That will be your beam fraction, because the summation of beam and diffuse, that will be the total global solar radiation. So in this way, we can find out the beam and diffuse fraction separately. Now the next target is to identify the hourly value. Okay. So whatever that we discussed till now, that is H, capital H, see here, and that H stands for daily average value. Okay. And bar means monthly value. And now we are interested to find out the hourly value. Okay, so that is indicated here by I. So it is nothing but the relation of some fraction RT is equal to I by H, hourly value divided by daily value, having some relation, then that RT is like this. You can use A and B, and again it is a function of the omega S, which is nothing but the hourly. Now again, once we have the hourly value, the next target is to identify from that hourly global value, you need to identify the diffuse and beam radiation separately. So again, the same procedure we are following. Beam IT by HT means the diffuse fraction from the hourly and from the global radiation on the daily basis, that also we are going to separate out. Same methodology. Now, once we have the diffuse solar radiation and the beam solar radiation separately based on the hour, the next task is to use the to identify or to determine the solar radiation on a tilted plane, because at a different location we are using the solar devices or the conversion devices at a certain tilt, and that is mostly equivalent to the latitude of the location, right? So what exactly amount of the solar radiation available at the tilt surface, that is our point of interest. Now, the diffuse solar radiation, we have the diffuse, beam and the reflected, three parts in our overall or the global or total solar radiation. So beam radiation is quite easy to estimate, it is directly falling onto the surface, but the diffuse fraction is quite unpredictable. We cannot say that this much amount of the radiation that will be absorbed or scattered. So for that, three different effects are considered: atmospheric scattering, reflection, and the multiple reflection, means reflecting from the one body to the another body and to the object. That three, particularly in the diffuse fraction. So that diffuse solar radiation is having the three types. First one is isotropic solar radiation, circumsolar, and the horizon brightening diffuse solar radiation. Isotropic are those ones which are having a uniform magnitude throughout the sky dome. Sky dome means we are assuming that above the observable location the sky is open, and that is assumed to be a dome. So sky dome we are considering. Circumsolar diffuse solar radiation, it is the solar radiation which is available just, explaining through figure, this one. See, this is sky dome. Whatever the solar radiation available here, that is isotropic diffuse. And circumsolar means whatever the beam solar radiation which is available, and just by just beside that beam, that is known as circumsolar. It is having a higher intensity. And third one is the horizon brightening, means whatever the solar radiation which is falling onto the earth surface and it is reflected back and it is brightening the surface of the earth surrounding. So it is indicated by this. Okay, so these are the three parts. And the final equation we now can say, it is the total solar, hourly solar radiation on the tilted surface, that is equal to ITB, that is a beam fraction, ID iso means a diffuse iso fraction, circumsolar diffuse solar radiation, horizon brightening, and IT reflection, that means the total reflected solar radiation which is we are getting at the object. Now, if we multiply it with the collector area means our object area, like solar photovoltaic device or the we can say concentrating solar device. So simply multiply it, because this unit is watt per meter square and this is meter square. So meter square will be cancelled out. So simply just to identify in terms of the watt on a tilted plane. So IB, RB, AC, again ID, ISO, AS, FSC. Now here, one quantity you observe is FSC, here FZ dash C. So that is nothing but the view factor or the conversion factor, or we can say tilt factor also. That is what actually FSC means, sky dome to collector. Whatever the surface, the sky dome, let us say this is our observer location or the collector location, whatever the sky that can see the surface of the collector, that is FSC. Similarly, horizon brightening to collector, and also this is the area of sky dome, area of horizon brightening, and area of the collector. These all factors are there. Here, rho I is the reflectivity of the earth surface. IC stands for any reflection from the ith object to the collector. Now, in the view factor algebra, we can use the reciprocity rule. That means sky dome area to view factor from the sky to the collector is equivalent to the collector area into view factor from the collector to sky. And that is also equal applicable for the horizon writing, and also we can say ith object from where the reflection is carried out. And instead of all this reflection from the multiple bodies, we are simply considering this one. Instead of this equation, sigma I, rho I, A I, F I, C, because we don't know where the solar radiation is exactly falling and from that how much amount of the reflection is coming. So instead of that, what we are doing, we are just considering the reflection of the ground. So ground reflectivity is considered, okay. And instead of A I, F I, C, what we are using? A C, F C, G, right. So just by using this reciprocity rule. And finally, we receive, we have this equation, that is ID, AC, IB, RB, AC, ID, ISO, and these all things, okay. And if we divide by IC, IC will be cancelled out. So finally, we have the IB, RB plus ID, ISO, FCS. Now see here, FC, collector to sky, then collector to horizon writing, and collector to ground. So this is your final equation for determining the tilted surface solar. Now, most commonly, this is the last model I would like to highlight. Actually, this is the task we completed here. This is final equation. And the most widely used equation for solar radiation on a tilted plane, that is the isotropic sky model. It is a very, very simple and linear model, simplest almost, and having a good accuracy. If we want to have a detail regarding that, it is available in book. And so many literature also. So what is that? Simply what we are doing, we are considering all the diffuse part as a one part. So ID is there, no ID ISO, no ID HZ, no ID circumzone. And the tilt factor or the FCD, that is 1 plus cosine beta. Again, it is an empirical equation. So 1 plus cosine beta by 2. And the reflectivity part on the reflective solar radiation, it is 1 minus cos beta by 2. Okay, so this is nothing but the FCS, this one, and FCG, collector to ground and collector to sky. So this method is, model is most widely used model. These are my references. You will find this many literature from this book, Chetan Singh Solanki, Fundamental Technology and Application, and these are all NET references. Thank you. Just 1 minute. Lecture is completed, but one thing I would like to highlight. If
time period lapse.
Just a
minute. Hello, sir.
Okay, sorry for interruption. One interesting fact I would like to share with you. Whatever we discussed till. Whatever we discussed right now, that is for solar resource availability. Okay. But the question is that everything starts from the historical data. So from where the historical data can be achieved. So for that, I'm just sharing one of the resources with you. See, So this is a data supply portal of the Indian Meteorological Department. You will find this web portal address dsp.imdpune.gov.in. Okay, from where you can get mostly all the weather data like the solar radiation, temperature, humidity, everything. Okay, so services they are providing like procedure for the data procurement, certificate payment procedure, data charges. So procedure for data and data request form, let me show you. These are the procedures. Data charges. Now see here, yes. If you want to get the radiation data, you have to see here what is the charges. You can see daily data is available, monthly data is also available, and this all data, whatever is available, that is for global total radiation on horizontal surface. Okay, it is not a tilted surface. Why it is not? Because that horizontal data is unique, and that you have to use and you have to identify the tilted surface data, because it is not fixed where you are going to install your solar conversion devices. So this is one way from where you can get the data. Of course, it is quite costly, but you can make your institute as a member of this IMD Pune. So after that, it will be very easy and very economic also. I think membership charges are, before few years, it was only 5,000 rupees. Now what is, I don't know. But once you are a member, you will get any kind of the data throughout the year free of cost. So that is the cheapest one. Otherwise, if you go for radiation data for a particular location for some time period, you will receive that. You will see here the charges are very high just for the one number of records. So this is just an interesting thing I would like to share with you. Thank you all. Thanks.
Thank you, sir, for informative lecture and covering various aspects of solar energy radiation and terminology related to assessment. Okay, now let me start the question answer session. Before that, I request Nandan bhai to give access to camera and mic to all the participants. Okay, now participants, please, you can ask the question. Now session is open for question answer. Anyone, please.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Actually, we have data, so radiation and temperature data from the authentic sources such as NREL, Homer Bro, and some site historical data. So there is any equations to calculate the solar power from the available resources?
Yes, definitely. That's what the aim of this subject of today's session, that was the to identify the resource assessment at a particular location. You are having a data that is a global or the total solar radiation on horizontal surface. That data you cannot use directly to identify the output of solar devices which you are supposed to install or supposed to making your research work on that. Okay. So very first, what you need to do, you have to identify the location angle, you have to identify the declination, you have to identify the N means number of days, for what days you are identifying the solar potential. So ultimately you need to identify the IT, whatever we discussed at the second last slide. IT means the solar radiation that is available on tilted plane. That is the most important thing, because whatever the available globally through free resources or through IMD also, or even any other software resources, whatever is available, that is based on horizontal surface only, not on the tilted plane. So okay, you have to convert it.
Okay. Any other question, participant, please?
Sir, may I speak?
Yes, please.
Yeah. Good afternoon. Really, it was very interesting presentation, and I got so many ideas through your presentation, and I think it will really helpful for me and my research scholars to pursue the research work. My basic question is, nowadays there are so many GIS softwares, especially ArcGIS is there. Even in quantum GIS, some functionalities are there to calculate the direct radiation, diffuse radiation, global radiation. Does there is any change in manual calculation and the calculation through software? Regarding the accuracy.
Yes, of course, I can understand your problem. There are so many softwares are available, sir. You might have heard about the Homer also. So Homer is available from the NREL. That software is also providing you the data regarding this hourly data, daily data, monthly data. So that is ultimately what I'm trying to say is that data is based on horizontal surface. But yes, whatever you said, that is right now the GIS softwares are available. They are directly giving the DNI values or the directly, we can say whatever the tilt we want, that data is also giving. But what ultimately they are running based on the algorithm. Whatever we discussed mathematical procedure, that same thing is also fitted in the background in the algorithmic steps. And they are calculating same things and they are giving you. Actually, what the procedure is given or highlighted here, that is including a use calculation. It is not just you have to put one value. You have to perform so many calculations either through software or through, you can also perform that, that calculation through the Excel also, but better to do with the MATLAB also. That is good. Means it is not just a one value. Thousands of values of the solar radiation you need to play, because you have to play with the historical data. And if you consider the one historical day, 1 year historical data, that means you are having a 8760 values. Okay, so if you consider 5 years data, multiply it with 5, so quantum of data that is used. So you have to take help from the softwares. It might be a GIS, it might be a real sensing devices, anything like the Homer, NREL or Excel also. It is possible.
Thank you, sir. If it is possible, please share your PPT. PPT means your presentation, because yes, it will yes. be easy to find out the equations and their meaning.
Yeah, everything will be shared with all the participants. Don't worry, it will be available in the public domain also very soon.
Okay.
After completion, everything will be.
Thank you, sir.
Under the norms of order. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I have one question.
Yes, sir.
Drastic climate change nowadays. How can you rely on historical data to estimate solar radiation in case nowadays a very drastic climate change we are seeing?
Yes, sir. That's why actually what I am, how we are getting the information about the like the rain. Okay, so they are predicting. Everything is based on prediction, and for the prediction you have to rely on the historical data. And the thing is that I also mentioned in the slide, if the larger amount of the data which is available, larger means larger bulk data is available, and if there is a accurate data, then your prediction will be good. So that is the first condition. You have a good quantum of data, and of course that data, whatever is available, that is accurate. Of course, it is the prime condition.
But does it take into account the recent climate change which is occurring globally?
Yes. So for that, what you can consider? You can consider some variation in your input data, like the sensitivity analysis we are performing in our research work normally. Suppose the solar radiation is available at a certain intensity. So we are involving a certain sensitivity like 10%, 20%, and we can identify the future prediction in terms of that.
Okay.
Yes, Abhijit sir, you want to say something?
No, this was my question from Abhijit.
Okay. Okay, fine. Thank you. Okay, anyone else?
Okay, so we should close this session. We have a break in 1:30. On top 1:30, we will start the next session.